course, to ban that one out. We'll see what EG decides to do. What are you doing?
This is interesting, because if Olaf gets banned, then every jungler that Zuna has played in the LCS will be banned. He has played Vi, Elise, and Olaf. Likewise for Snoopy, though, he's played Elise, Sin, and a Gragas jungle. Both of those were in fairly bad defeats. Obviously, I don't think first pick is going to be a jungler here, because you know there's plenty of more priorities on the map now that all the junglers have been banned away.
It's going to be a tight one for those guys. The Gragas is still left up, but the LeBlanc has been taken out.
Plenty of stuff. Ziggs,
see
maybe
that coming.
Depending if ManCloud wants to just play a pusher, he's been struggling this year. But they're taking the Thresh away from Kreppo. They've actually denied him his top two supports.
Yeah, you get the Leona out, get the Thresh out of there as well. Kreppo is really kind of the meat of that bottom lane to make things happen.
Maybe they're going to try and force him back on Lulu, because it was only a week ago these guys played against each other. Kreppo played Lulu in that matchup. Bloodwater played Thresh. It worked out for him in that game. That was a very good showing by Xsmithie and Bloodwater in the bot lane.
Him and Yellow Pete haven't had the greatest time in that lane. We'll see if they can bring it back in this one.
They had that one game where they got two kills.
On Wiz.
Three kills, actually, really early on in the game. And they just did not carry through with that. I would not be surprised if Snoopy takes jungle Gragas again. He likes the idea of it. It's a strong early game jungler. He hasn't really excelled on much. Surprisingly enough, both of these teams' only wins came when their junglers were playing Olaf. So it's all losses.
Ooh, really?
I would love this.
The mana battery. Very nice. A little bit of Soraka getting picked in here.
There's been more and more Soraka getting played in solo lanes, actually. But I actually expect this to be a support. I personally think that Soraka is a weak laning support.
Okay.
But if you get into the mid or late game, she just gets exceedingly strong. And also, if EG is picking a very tanky lineup, Soraka is just much, much better. I've said it before, but heals almost double in effectiveness, or triple, depending on how much armor you have. Since the heal stays the same, but the amount of damage someone has to put into you when you have more armor is more to get the damage down.
See how they use that within the ganks and the even counter gank here, as it looks like they have a team that'll be quite privy to getting in and out of some tricky fights.
Absolutely. So we get to see Zuna Lee Sin right now.
He's been shied away from quite a bit. Or not shied away, but just not picked.
Yeah. It's interesting how when XGG references why Zuna is going to be good in the jungle, it's because he makes a lot of calls, they don't want to be distracted, and they always cite Smithy's mechanics when they say they want to move to AD carry, which makes me think that XGG is saying, okay, Smithy has better mechanics than Zuna. Following the same logic, he's really playing some mechanically complex junglers. The fact that he's wanted to play nothing but Elise and Lee Sin, those are hard junglers to play. Even Olaf as well, which is his one that he wants to play the most. I'm skeptical of the success of this Lee Sin. He's going to have to prove it.
Well, it's kind of been the factor of how a team would beat another right now in the NALCS. Look for the weak point, the changes in the teams, and then hit it. Hotshot got hit yesterday.
Nice. This is nice from EG. Sorry to cut you off.
No. They do lock it in. It's worthy.
This lane goes way back. I remember Season 2 when Urgot was all that. It was the Soraka-Urgot lane, and it was all about you had to take them away from each other because they were too effective with each other. Like, you just land one thing with Urgot, you mana battery him up over and over again. He can just spam once he locks down. And it also works for the tankiness, because Urgot actually builds a lot of armor and MR later in the game. He's maybe going to go... He might go for the Mermana Black Cleaver build with Last Whisper that isn't as tanky, but he might also go for a Frozen Heart, like the old school Urgots used to do, which when combined with the Soraka heals, this is just a team of tanks and a Soraka for EG.
And that's an awesome synergy as well. You get the Hyperkinetic Position Reverser in,
all the
or Gragas hits somebody, and then you grab that person, and oh my gosh. Yeah, it's going to be a pretty sick composition coming out from EG. We'll see what XDG can do, whether they're scrambling or not, or trying to say, we're just go for what we really wanted to go for here. It's going to be interesting.
Yeah, right now for XDG, obviously Smithy has not played Sivir this season. There's been one Shyvana game from Benny, and that was in their loss against Curse. But it's a very solid-looking composition by XDG. They have tons of AoE damage, an incredibly strong team fight. They chased down really well. They had that synergy with Sivir and Shyvana, where the Sivir ultimate will allow Shyvana to stick to targets better.
Right.
This is a very standard and extremely strong team composition from XDG. Mm-hmm. It's just so unknown because we haven't seen a composition like EG has brought out in so long interact with one of these. I don't want to call them a modern 2014 composition that XDG has run.
And the thing that it surprises me about that for EG is usually it's Pobelter and Inox that want to run the carries. But they're leaving it on actually the lane that's had the hardest trouble for that team to make the plays this game.
Yeah, well, here we're actually going to get to see as if it's a mid lane Gragas or a jungle Gragas.
That's true.
Because Snoopy can still pick what he wants. Pobelter's a very experienced Gragas player. And it's a jungle Gragas.
That is.
So,
wow.
Holy crap, let me think about this for 1 second.
A little bit of poke there.
I got it now.
All right, where are we going with this?
It's basically a little bit similar to what Curse Academy was running in the Challenger, where they don't really have an AD carry. They just have a whole bunch of tanks. And the strategy is you sit back and they just swapped it again. They still have a whole bunch of tanks. But now it's even stronger poke. What I was going to say is EG was going to sit back and throw Nidalee Spears. And if the team engages on them, they're basically having to engage through a front line, which is going to be Mundo and Urgot, which are going to try and hold strong for them. But now they have an AP Gragas and an AP Nidalee, which Inox actually did well on yesterday in a loss, both poking with max AP, but still having a tank line, what they lacked yesterday, because they're trying to get it back with AD carry. It's a very outside-the-box composition by EG here.
More interesting things in every game that we have. We'll get back to chatting about the teams. But right now, as the champs are locked in, we're going to see who you locked in to take the first win of the day. According to LOLesports.com, 65% of you think it will be Evil Geniuses that come out on top.
Yeah, well, XTG is never going to grow old in getting voted down in these games. Last split, they completely exceeded expectations from fans. This split, they're actually underperforming because they were voted to win in a few. EG still having fan hope behind them. It's slowly waning. But if they break out compositions like this and they win with it, it will just speak volumes to their potential for the rest of the year. This is actually, I think, a bit of a desperation move by EG just because it's so different. Mm-hmm. Bringing back something like Urgot and Soraka is really a call back to when Kreppo and Yellowpete were top of the world or very close to AD carry and support. That was the game they were used to playing. Now they're going back to it, even though everyone else has kind of moved on. If it still works, that means they can still exist here in the LCS. But if it doesn't, it's just another failed experiment.
Well, Jed, it is a team game. They are three core players coming in here to grab Inox and Pobelter, so we'll see if it can synergize with all five. We are on to the Rift and into your first game of the day. See where they decide to go, and you can see the start is different right off the bat for Yellowpete, Longsword, and the Potions.
Yeah, absolutely. So not even going with the Doran's Blade, that shows a lot of swagger in that bottom lane. Really, just because you lose out of a lot of early combat stats by not going Doran's. Sure, he has a couple extra potions, but that means he's probably going for an extremely early Brutalizer. And he's going to be trying to cut through, most likely Thresh. That's the interesting thing about that lane as well. Mm. Sivir can spell shield the lock-on, the goo that Urgot throws up. I got to look up his skill names again. The Noxian Corrosive Charges, which is his E. And he's going to hit him with Acid Hunters, which is basically just an Ezreal Q.
I'm probably not going to say all of those during his fights.
Yeah?
We still have the line of scrimmage being set up by both teams. As I'm sure XDG is kind of wondering, how is this going to play out? What are they going to do? And how does that the Urgot and Soraka lane play out? Is it aggressive early, or do they just kind of do their thing until you can get the team swapping?
Yeah, it's rather interesting. I think they're pretty weak at level 1, unless Urgot can really get in auto-attack range, which is hard for him because it's so short. Mm. At level 2, if they land a couple skill shots, they have the potential to aggress. And then level 6 is usually the other big time they hit power. But when this lane was popular, it was often ran with Nocturne, and it was all about brute force ganking at level 6 because they would Urgot swap as a Nocturne ulted in and get a kill. They can't necessarily do that with Snoopy, so the lane's kind of on its own. I actually think this lane might be a little bit more of a farm lane for Yellowpete and Kreppo, even though Urgot you think of as someone who's supposed to be a lane bully.
We also haven't seen...
Starts with Starcall, too. So they're really trying to shove this lane.
Oh, yeah. Getting that all the way pushed up to the tower, that's going to almost pull Zuna down here quite a bit.
It's going to try and make him come down really quickly, you're right. X Smithy can counter shove extremely well because he is Sivir. But if EG can make this a farm lane, I think it's good for them overall.
See if they keep this pressure. This will reset a bit on the lane, so they're good so far on the first push, but it is still just going to be star calls coming in after that. We'll see what Snoopy can do here. And speaking of Snoopy, Mundo is somebody we see in the jungle, but not as much lately.
Yeah, Snoopy is pretty much exclusively a top laner because he gets dangerously low in the jungle in his early clears. So his early game ganks are definitely not that potent. What this means is EG is putting a lot of stress on their somewhat struggling lanes already to not die to Zuna's Lee Sin ganks.
Looks like they have the push in the bottom lane, so Zuna doesn't have to tend to that one just yet. They give the ward in mid, so Mancloud can start to be a little bit more aggressive. We saw when Skara got his wards in mid, that's when they started focusing him. We'll see how they play it.
Another thing we need to touch on, actually. Mm-hmm. As long as nothing happens in that lane.
Whoa!
Is how XDG's planned synergy of moving Zuna to the jungle was supposed to benefit Benny greatly. How they're saying, oh, all Smithy used to do was gank for Mancloud. And, like, personally, I don't think that's a problem. Mancloud had the most kills in the history of a split in the LCS. He averaged 6 kills a game. So far in this split with Zuna as a jungler, he has 11 kills over 5 games. He's averaging 2 kills a game. He's nothing like the player he was last split with Zuna in the jungle.
No, and we see in the bottom lane, they're doing a great job at dodging out these attacks. The hooks that are coming in, we'll see if Mancloud actually can get himself some kills by roaming down here, because I feel like this lane will be fighting once they get those 5s and 6, very much so.
Yeah, you could see actually the benefit of the Sivir pick against Urgot right there. Just being able to spell shield the Noxian Corrosive Charge or the Urgot E. See if Zuna can do anything. He's standing right on top of a ward.
Yep. Then he told them that. That's the synergy.
Did you know Urgot's passive name is Zaun Touched Bolt Augmenter?
I do now.
Yeah. It's actually one of the most powerful passes in the game, and people don't necessarily treat it as such. It's 15% reduced damage for enemy targets, which means he wins almost every trade if he can get it off on them.
Oh, that was a pretty nice flash there by Zuna, and he gets a safeguard to the ward previously placed.
It was a nice flash, but he didn't get anything out of it.
No.
It's like he was invading the wolves, the raids, not to kill, but to just harass a little bit. Yellow Peak gets played, though.
He gets really close just to get that CS, the hook being down for just a few seconds, and it looks like they are just winning these lane trades now.
Really nice shot there at the end by X Smithy, and this is kind of Soraka being a little weak in lane. Krepo cannot go toe-to-toe with Bloodwater, which means even though Yellow Peak can kind of outduel X Smithy, it's a bit of a 2-on-1 or a 1.5-on-1. Let's see if Snoopy can turn something because EG's lane is looking real weak.
Oh, he walks right into Snoopy, but Snoopy's not going to go for him. Not even put extra damage on it. He holds the cleaver for Bloodwater, and they get the flash. Could be just as good.
That was a little bit interesting.
Yes.
How they decided to get Thresh's flash instead of X Smithy's because either one of those guys was going to have to flash away from Snoopy, and he picked that it would be Bloodwater. To me, that may have been a conscious choice. Let's watch when Yellow Pete and Krepo get level 6 if they go directly to kill Bloodwater, knowing that his flash is down, because he would have been the easier target to kill in the first place since he has no spell shield.
It is true. They are close. Inox having to blow his flash in the top lane, so they trade on those on either sides of the teams.
Nice shot by Zuna there. You can see Inox is holding his own quite well against Shyvana, but he's going to have to shop pretty quickly. And this is the worst time of the lane for someone like him. Benny is resourceless right now on Shyvana, especially because he hits level 6, and he is never going to relent the pressure in this lane. So whenever Inox goes back, his turret is going to take a huge amount of damage. That's why Snoopy has to come all the way up and babysit just so he can shop.
Yep. Zuna came around very nicely on that. Benny told him the ward was gone, so that synergy that they have is just always on point. A deep ward by the Wraiths just placed by Mancloud. We'll see if that plays anything soon.
Yeah, XDG is putting a lot of importance on that spot of the map. You could see Zuna invading earlier, having to burn his own flash to escape, and now they put the ward there. So it's a lot of just trying to catch Snoopy in his rotations, making sure the Mundo ganks don't go anywhere. It's needed because XDG is trying to push all of their lanes at once here. Benny gets caught.
Oh, he dies back in, and he gets for his blood! The cleavers are going to be too much, but he does it in style.
Yeah, that was a stylish kill right there, but I don't think it's worth it. He gave away a kill and an assist for the first blood. Overall, EG gets more gold out of that if Zuna can't turn anything here, which he can't.
Zuna and Snoopy very close to level 6 there, but neither of them able to use it in that engagement. Pobelter coming in on level 6 for both of them. But it looks like he's going to be forced to back off. He didn't go very hard on that, and he had the advantage.
Yeah. He just missed his body slam. Mm-hmm. His burst would have been much higher. I think if he lands that, he probably tries to alt Man Cloud backwards and go for something big. Probably burn a barrier out of Man Cloud. But because it didn't land, he was just like, nope, getting out of here. Not going to work.
Zuna, very Olaf-esque as he did last time, spending a lot of time there in the enemy jungle, but it might get him in trouble this time. A big bomb coming in from Mancloud, but I don't think it's going to be enough. The dodge happens so the big man can get in range.
Well, right there is why he was holding his ultimate, and now level 5 bottom lane, you can see the damage coming in a little bit from Yellow Pete and Crepo. They're getting dangerously close to that level 6 and might try and turn something aggressive. EG's staying in this game.
We just saw Xmithie and Bloodwater freezing, super freezing this lane so they can put this pressure back on. Yellow Peak gets hit up. There's the shield. You can see the armor revolving around Urgot for that short amount of time. Keeps him safe.
And it's a massive creep wave. Otherwise, EG might have stayed. They're actually going for a kill here because Pete is so low.
Oh, getting a little antsy. They called it, but I don't think they were ready to fully go in. I'm going to back off for now, chat.
Putting on his dancing shoes for the four-legged crab caught right there, barely dodging out on some of those boomerangs. Not too much burned though. Smithy didn't have to burn any summoners outside of his ultimate. Everybody calm down in that lane.
So as we look around, Man Cloud picking up his blue, which is gonna help in a 71-59 mid lane. He's got a pretty good lead over Popelter there.
Yeah, Man Cloud, definitely the better farmer. Gragas will be able to catch up a little bit once his barrels can clear the back wave. But for now, no one out CS's Ziggs early on in the game, unless Ziggs is misplaced.
And it's interesting, we actually see these two facing each other. Usually one's banned, and the other's picked in favor. And Inox hit up again. He actually goes for Zuna. Zuna remembers what happened last time. He takes it careful.
That was a nice shot there by Zuna, but here's the aggression.
Again onto Yellow Pete. Where's Crepo coming in? Snoopy a little too far behind. They were wishing they had the lantern on that.
See, I don't understand that moment from EG because they Urgot ulted the Sivir even though Bloodwater's flash was down. And you can't necessarily go for Sivir if you're isolating one target because you swap him back and he just lanterns in the other direction. That gank is never going to work if you ult Sivir. That's why they burned the flash in the first place, but now they go for Dragon.
They have enough aggression to actually push back onto Dragon. A very nice Mega Inferno bomb. Crepo's sitting on the backside, and it looks like they're going to take quite a bit of a hit here. Everybody's in the pit. Oh, man, it was a party for a second. 10 minutes on the clock. The Dragon does go over to Snoopy. They were able to find their way through that mosh pit.
We had to see everyone's reaction right there
while we
were in the Dragon pit. But really, that was kind of the power of EG's composition there. When everybody got low, Soraka popped the ultimate and really made XGG miscalculate the fight. Soraka heals for more the lower the targets are, and it's a new change in the 2014 season that people really haven't gotten used to playing against. It's tremendous baiting potential. EG looked like they were in a really bad place there, but they persevered, no one died, they got the dragon, and a kill.
Yeah, that was super duper scary. Even gold, 3-2, 10.5 minutes into the game, and that turret has fallen in the top lane. Benny has been putting a lot of pressure onto Inox, and really the first time we looked up there, Benny was getting pushed out of lane, so he's been adapting well.
Benny has actually been getting a fair bit of help from Zuna,
yeah,
I think, in that lane, and he kind of needs it. You can see Inox's top lane Nidalee is no joke. Mm-hmm. He has done well on it in lane now 2 games in a row. He played it against Dignitas yesterday. Could never transition into the rest of the game. But I have a feeling right now that even though EG is down in turrets, because their laning phase is admittedly weak, they've stuck around in the game long enough that I think once they start grouping, they might have a substantial advantage.
Xmithie and Bloodwater are having no more of being pushed back into their own turret. They are giving it tenfold here to Yellow Pete and Crepo. And they really can't do much about it. You're right on rushing that Brutalizer, and he's stacking the tier up, so it's a bit of a plateau in damage now.
Yeah, well, he's going to keep going. He's going to go for a Black Cleaver,
yep,
and most likely a Mura Mana after that. And people don't realize how quickly Black Cleaver stacks on Urgot, because his Noxian Corrosive Charge is ticking physical damage, so just landing one of them basically guarantees you get the max shred out of it.
Watching the movement, it is going to be Pobelter. Not really coming all the way down. He was hovering top, but it is Snoopy again with presence in the bottom lane. He keeps putting some focus here because Yellow Pete and Crepo were supposed to be the ones to make plays this time.
Yeah, well, with the Soraka, it's incredibly difficult to make plays, but when you pick an Urgot, it's kind of that thing. You want to swap them in.
Yep.
They don't have the flash down on Bloodwater this time, so I'm not sure what Snoopy's planning here.
Now there's the difference of the spell shield as well. Now they can use that. This could be foiled very quickly for EG if they try something. It looks like Yellow Pete could have wanted that, but they're yeah. keeping their behavior quite set in this.
As long as Bloodwater stays out of range of the swap, Xsmithy is safe. He will always be able to click the Lantern as long as Bloodwater keeps the distance.
They got to see that it's being played a little bit different. Xsmithy and Bloodwater are staying so far off of this. And Snoopy, he's taking a vacation down here. But there's the swap. They finally tried to get it in.
And he's out.
Xsmithy gets the Lantern. They couldn't get towards it. They get the lock onto Yellow Pete. And the Knife Blade backwards. The box stops it all.
Yeah, that was a little bit more dangerous than XGG wanted it to be because they did have to burn Bloodwater's flash. Mm-hmm. But it was the Lantern back immediately. Maybe they could catch Bloodwater afterwards. But the swap itself didn't really do much to initiate or help that gank.
Really looks so calmly played. Oh, wow, Benny, this isn't the first time it's happened to Inox. He gets the Ignite on him, so the heal won't come out, but he flashes out of the bush. He gets the heal just in time.
Inox is getting a lot of pressure put on him by Benny, at least. His shoving is not working out. You can see the mana is a definite issue for Inox. He cannot heal up through this repeated pressure from Benny. Mid lane, Zuna going for something.
Skill shots going back and forth. Gets blown out by the explosive cast. Pobelts are not taking too much damage. Those resistances keeping him pretty healthy right now.
Wow.
The wish comes in. Can they go for the kill? It's going to be one more hit. He gets the barrel. They may not stop. Zuna gets hit with another cleaver. Snoopy has the aggro, but they say no.
Pobelter played that magnificently right there, landing all of his shots with a flash body slam right at the end, basically sustaining a 1v2 gank until his ally could arrive.
Uh-oh. The tides have changed in this one. Benny's on the run now. The game
no
of
alternate.
Cat and mouse
got
in favor
though.
Of the cat, very much so. The dragon is going to go down. Assist going to Snoopy on a cleaver from the left side.
I guess he didn't think the flash would cover enough distance since Nidalee is so fast with pounces, but he still has his flash after giving up that death. I would say Benny definitely overstayed his welcome there against Inox because he had went back and shopped, had become more powerful, and Benny was not relenting his pressure.
Might be getting a little comfortable. We saw Benny multiple tower dives in the top lane, so he'll reassess that situation, seeing Inox come back. He really doesn't have much to stop Benny, though. Looks like he can still chew through that top lane. We'll see if they keep trying to split push each other out.
Yeah, I'm really liking EG's position right here.
Mm-hmm.
I think very soon, since Inox has hit his Athenes and Holy Grail, and so has Pobelter, those are the big ticket items for both those guys. They can siege objectives amazingly well, and then as long as the damage is focused around Snoopy and Yellow Pete, those guys are going to be damn near indestructible when you consider they're going to have Nidalee heals and Soraka heals, plus Soraka's passive magic resist buff, the armor that the heal is going to provide. Just so much healing on top of the tankiness from EG. This is a little bit like the composition I've been waiting for someone to run, where it's just a bunch of heals and tanks because they synergize so well with each other. They just got the poke mixed in there so they actually have damage.
Oh, Zuna kicking back Snoopy. It doesn't look like they'll be able to get the turret against XDG. That's nicely saved. But they do have a 2,000 gold lead, so that would have only increased it a little bit. Dragons in 10 seconds. You see that just being used, the ultimate of Zuna. So their fight potential is still there, but they lose a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, they're still getting a little aggressive. I wonder why they're sticking around.
Well, it looks like they're going to be thrown down on the hunt to get Bloodwater out of this situation. His flash is still down. They are focusing the right person this time. They put him back in the end, and it actually causes the death sentence to go way past. Zuna returns to the lane. Remember, the ultimate is down here.
Oh, Pete's out of mana.
It's all about the regular reel of spells that he can use. And this one, they turn around, and he's throwing down the barrier. Able to pull up the kills. Krepo is running away. He should be able to save himself on this one. He's got a good 900 HP. They go into the turret.
He's got an ultimate right now.
Smithy's
on the backside.
Zuna's got a few hits. Throws down the wish. Throws down the HP. It's going to be Xsmithy tanking the last shot, and he gets out with only one.
Really nice tower dive by XTG. They're getting three kills basically just for Mancloud. And in mid lane, something happened as well. Pobelter goes aggro. Didn't quite catch this, but he pops him backwards. It looks like he just finishes off the kill.
Pobelter knows he has the upper hand in that. You can see it in the play.
So this is Pobelter right now, doing his thing. Inox diving in the top lane.
Woo.
One thing that used to happen in solo queue that became kind of an in-joke amongst top-tier players, because Pobelter is known for being incredibly inconsistent. He has Pobelter and he has another account. And anytime he would do well, everyone in the game would just be like, is that Poe Belter? Because Poe Belter is the one that's supposed to do good all the time. And his Smurf is the one that does not.
All right. Again, very nice dragon going over to EG. That's two for them. Gold lead is becoming quite big there. Now, this is kind of the point in time we have to remember the leads that EG has likely slip away.
Well, no. The only time EG's been able to pull ahead in the game was against CLG. And that was the one early games
not
have
grabbing
been
a, leads.
Yeah, their early games have been atrocious. So the fact that they've survived this early game, gotten two turrets to two, secured both dragons, speaks very highly for their potential right here.
Oh my word.
Nice
Wrong
shot.
Place at the right time for EG. Snoopy still on the backside, a great cleaver and the barrel follow-up. Great play, great synergy.
Snoopy and Poe Belter are becoming a bit of a tag team. Mainly just Poe Belter because he is crushing people right now. But Snoopy cannot be denied. 6 out of the 8 kills participating. Becoming a pretty effective jungle Mundo. And something that's going to be silly is Mundo plus Soraka heals. That guy's going to be unkillable.
Oh,
this is too many people for XDG to handle right here. They have both flashes up. Let's see if they can escape.
This is a party indeed. Krepo's going to be just standing next to Bloodwater. They're walking along with him.
Still got flash.
Looks like they're going to be... Oh, my gosh. Wait a minute. If they don't get anything out of this, no way. Grabs up Poe Belter under the turret. Nick Smitty, they stay safe. They don't even take damage.
Well, that's some
they're
nice
gonna,
synergy
gonna lose
right
the
there
turret.
XDG.
That works.
Juking all the skill shots. Wow. Cleavers missed. Barrels missed. Benny fight.
This is an awesome skill matchup up top. Inox and Benny. Inox, rather. Face-to-face the entire time. This time, it's Benny's.
And I think all this... The catalyst for all this was the roam from EG down bottom. The failed roam gave everyone else an XGG the ability to go aggressive.
Whoop! Snoopy has not a good bounty on his head, but he's definitely worth a little bit of money. Popping the alt to get out of that.
It's one of the fastest-paced EG games I think I've ever seen right here because Poe Belter specifically is making a lot of plays, and XDG, I got to give credit to Benny here, is trying to do his job to carry the game here. This is kind of what XDG talked about when they talked about Zuna in the jungle, is... Benny says if Zuna gives me a few kills, right. I'm going to be the one that gets strong. I'm going to be the one that carries the game. Because it's definitely not looking like Mancloud. He's 0-2. He hasn't been getting too much jungle help from Zuna.
And that's the thing. At what point do you kind of change that and you make that synergy? Because Snoopy's been focusing Poe Belter's help.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. It's a team decision that they're going to have to figure out. Whether it's just Mancloud underperforming or whether he's just too used to being ganked for. And he hasn't adapted his playstyle. It's been a long time since the last season.
20 minutes into this matchup. See the kills. 4 onto Poe Belter right now. He looks like he could lead his team to victory. Grabbing up a blue buff. These guys will be setting up. We saw the dragon go down just a little bit ago. Mm-hmm. So whatever they do set up for, it's going to be for the lane pressure right now. And figuring out what mistake XDG can make next.
Look at how little vision they had right there when we turned it off.
Yeah.
EG doesn't have much, but at least you burn the flash.
Sometimes that mistake is just the wrong pathing. Like you said, the wards for EG, a lot better than XDG right now. Those little instances of opportunity able to be created. Poe Belter double buffed up right now, and it looks like EG is going to want to start taking down structures in mid.
Yeah, I think this is the time where EG wants to set up their seed. There's a death cap completed onto Poe Belter. And a Void Staff completed on Inox. Inox is actually right now just trying to keep Benny occupied, but since he has it shoved up, you know, whenever they could get into a position where they're double sieging with Gragas Barrels and Nidalee Spears, that is just too much to handle for XDG. They don't have any healing on them. They could definitely start taking out people in masses.
Can we take a look at Mundo? Snoopy actually just right out Warmogs. Let me get this.
Yeah,
my
he's a rich man. 6,500 gold. He's 1,400 ahead of Zuna. Obviously, Poe Belter as well is the most farmed member on the team. What is surprising amongst all this, though, is the fact that Inox is actually ahead in gold on Benny.
Ooh.
And there's the strength of Snoopy, just 1v1ing Smithy, making him run the heck away.
Yeah, EG, a little bit of the driver's seat here. They are able to dictate most of the movements of XDG right now. Benny and Inox are still having their party back and forth in the top lane. That would have been a nice grab, but I don't know how much XDG would have wanted that. That was a scary position.
Krepo's feeling pretty comfortable right now.
Yeah.
Because he's escaped the early game of Soraka. He doesn't necessarily have items yet, but the levels are really what matters for her. When he gets level 11, the extra healing from his wish, which is Soraka's ultimate, is going to be very, very important to him. And they have They have taken control of this map. They are now pushing XCG around. They didn't necessarily have the ward coverage, but that's a nice kick.
Oh, that was pretty cheeky by Pobelter. Back and forth. Oh, Zuna hits it. And Elite Syndrome's right into the fight. He looks like he's going to stay alive, but he is bleeding, limping away. A last auto attack able to take him down and possibly even a bushwhack. Smithy and Mancloud both go down below half. Inox hitting the spears. Here come the Acid Hunters as well from the backside. And that poke you were talking about, chat. EG is coming out with it everywhere.
If Inox wasn't out of mana, this would be an easy, easy siege. But he's a little... Oh, he can get pumped a little bit by Soraka. He was low before. Soraka just gave it back. They're going to take this turret now off the back of that fight.
Your mobile mana battery in Crepo right now on Soraka. The Talisman of Ascension finished for them there. So even if On the Hunt comes out, they can still go past this and chase on.
If anyone's been tracking Inox's mana, he was out of it that last fight. Oh, he couldn't quite get in range for the swap. That would have been a kill if he was another inch forward.
Mancloud waddling away quickly. Good catch on the spell shield as Xmithie packs a little bit more mana into his bottle. Yeah. See, 37,000 to 32 now. 4-3 in turrets. And EG is really being definitive this game.
Yeah, and infuse with the Soraka changes. We haven't seen Soraka, so these are rather interesting in quite a while.
Yeah.
She donates 60 mana plus 5% of her max mana, which right about now is every time she casts it, 102 mana. Directly to another target. It costs him a little bit, but Crepo doesn't necessarily care because he's got so much mana regen from his fully upgraded talisman. This is a little dangerous though. They're low on a lot of resources here.
They throw him in. He's going to put down the box. No! Bloodwater gets knocked around quite a bit, but the HP bars are not in the favor of EG right now. We'll see if they can turn it around. Pobelter goes down. That's a lot of DPS that EG does not have in this fight now. Benny and Snoopy duking it out as the tanks do in the bottom side of this fight. Crepo now on the other side. He misses the Q. Zuna looks to get a few more, but that HP! It was the barrel that's going to... Not the barrel, rather. The damage coming in to lock him down from Ziggs on the bomb.
Really good initiation by XTG there, and a disastrous fight for EG. They were low on resources, they had not landed any poke, and this fight was not going to work from the start. You could see they were just switched up. The great flash play by Bloodwater comboed with pretty much everything. Dragon's Descent plus the Ziggs Bomb just took EG out of the fight. Inox was low on mana, could not get pumped up by Crepo, and despite the heals and the tanks that they had, everything went wrong for them. The worst part about all of this though, Riv, is that since it was a 4-0 at about the 24-minute mark, it could mean a Baron for XTG, which is exactly what they need to come back.
And as you see them doing it right now, it took a little bit, but they are able to take it down. Xmithie and the team going back to buy some more items. That's the first Baron of the game. We are exactly 25 minutes in. Pobelter is going to be saying, hey guys, we got some turtling to do.
Yeah, that's a kick in the gut for EG, because they just escaped the early game. All they really had to do is execute throughout the mid game, and they should have been willing to concede a dragon to a team that had just all shopped. They were coming straight from their base, and EG had been away from home for far too long. That was just a missed call that ended up costing them thousands and thousands of gold and a huge amount of momentum in this game.
See if they can pick it back up. Things haven't been too hard, but that is a huge swing to be reckoned with. Gold now is split between that 4,000 lead. It's now down to 2,000. Smithy, or X-Smithy, I should say, finally getting a little bit of attack speed and crit into his build. He rushed that Bloodthirster into Last Whisper right off the bat.
Yeah, I love that build for Sivir, because everyone used to do the Legolas build for Varus since he was so spell-based in his damage. Sivir's Boomerang Blade does much more than a Piercing Arrow if you can land both ticks of it, so why would you not just build the exact same thing on Sivir? Now he's getting some attack speed, which is also the right choice because he needs to multiply his damage on items. XGG feeling pretty strong, and I haven't really talked about their composition too much thus far in the game because it has really been all about this unconventional EG composition. But XGG shows how powerful they can be in teamfights as long as they don't get poked down. The initiation can be very clean, and if they're landing their AoE on the priority targets, not the tanks by EG, things will work out great for them.
EG's making it hard, though. They're only saying you're getting in this team fight if it's from an Urgot swap. They are staying really great positioning, keeping in mind that they have to, you know, consistently do this. If they go awry, this strategy can fall apart immediately.
Yeah, and the last time EG tried to run a top lane AP in Italy, they really struggled because Dignitas fast pushed down their mid turrets and just brute forced their way through. They had a Zed middle in that game. Pobelter couldn't clear the waves. But now, he absolutely can
One barrel gets the front wave. He's got a blue buff. Back barrel gets the back wave. And no push happens for XTG. This time they actually have the wave clear to make up for the fact that Inox's top laner can't clear.
Well, if they do see Inox at the opportune an inopportune time for EG, the Talisman of Ascension is now finished on Bloodwater, so they can synergize that with an On the Hunt and get right where they need to and get into that fight.
A little bit faster than EG. And Pete surprised me a little bit by finishing his Last Whisper before his Black Cleaver. It's most likely because it's more armor penetration for himself, and most of the time he'll have a little bit of physical damage on the rest of the team, but it's pretty much all magic damage on the rest of them. So the Last Whisper was the proper choice. He'll finish that later. Not sure if he goes for Frozen Heart or Black Cleaver next, but it's pretty much the build we expected from him as well.
And usually the Aegis to lock it is going onto the support, but Zuna picks that up for his team coming into this game.
Yeah, Tank Lee Sin tends to do that fairly often. Zuna is trying to be the initiator for his team as well. Don't disagree with that. I hope he gets the locket completed soon for XDG's sake. They're just trying to use this Baron to farm a little bit back in the game. They were in a monstrous hole before they got that Zuna teamfight victories. And this is one of those pseudo comeback Barons where they're not getting much.
Oh. Tank Zuna feeling pretty tanky.
The silence there.
Oops.
Yeah. Zuna got completely outplayed. I'll talk about it later. There's a fight.
A little bit out silence. 1v1 in the 80 carries in the bottom lane. Oh, he flashes for it. One more. Acid Hunter. Can it burn down? There's no damage there.
No, Acid Hunter's gone as well. Oh, dear. That is the Urgot just turning it on and fighting X-Smithy. That's not going to do much. The reason Zuna got outplayed in the top lane was he went in for the kick right as Krepo arrived for the silence. So he actually just ward-jumped deeper into the team and couldn't kick back. That's when Pobelter capitalized and spiked it down.
He is doing well for himself. Got to keep an eye on Pobelter. It's 5-1-2 as we watch Benny and Inox go at it again in the top lane. Oh, they're calling for help on this one. Here comes the cavalry.
Got
to
flash the next
and
cleaver.
Krepo.
He
flashed it, but he took it with him. That's unfair. They're going to be able to take him down. It's a little bit of a shutdown there.
EG gets right back in the driver's seat now, I think, because the Baron buff is gone from XDG. They still have a gold lead, and they have just proven that they can win a couple of different sides of the map. Yellow Pete out-traded X-Smithy, stopped him in his tracks, and the only thing left is that Inox needs to deal with Benny. As long as he can get roam help from the rest of his team, it's evident that he can.
Zuna really hasn't been giving him too much synergy after this. Mancloud still not getting his kills, averaging the 2 kills a game. He's got 0 right now, but he does have the 4 assists, which means he's still trying to get that kill participation in. We'll see what they can keep doing. We're seeing Inox not really using Nidalee as Siege, but just towards the top lane. Is that going to start hurting him?
No. Well, he's just had to deal with Benny, but he has farmed up so much now. These are like the key Nidalee blow you up items.
Yeah.
And XTG hasn't had to deal with it throughout the game here, so if they can ever get into a poke scenario, that's when it's going to start being very effective. They pop the Talisman, but cannot close.
XTG saying, this is ours. Feeling a little bit greedy that they can move into the jungle. Pink Ward's going down as well as they get a lock onto Snoopy. Not exactly what they wanted. They're going to hold off on that.
Fascinating point in the game right here, actually. If EG can set up a 5-man siege, they're golden. But they're very scared of engaging in a 5-man fight without getting any siege down. You can see the danger pings they're going. They would love to get this dragon right now, but XGG is in a good position. As long as they avoid poke, XGG has the edge. If EG lands any poke, it immediately turns around.
You can get those spears in from the outside. You can see Inox nicely staying on the back line. A great boomerang hit to Inox. Xsmithie's trying to cut the pie here and get to the back line from being on the side of the fight. But it looks like XDG is just eventually getting kind of pushed out farther and farther.
And the dragon is still up. The fact that XDG couldn't finish off that dragon really quickly, it's going to make him really tough to get back in here right now because the poke war is extremely one-sided. XD is just trying to dodge things. It's not like EG is going to get poked too hard back. Since they have Soraka and Nidalee, if anything were to land, they would just heal it up.
They just put a question mark on that turret in the bottom lane. We'll see if they actually put him there. Pobelter says he can take 2 on for this situation. The flame misses, which means there's a little bit of that crowd control missing. And now they took down the death sentence. What's going to be happening over the dragon? Pobelter goes 3v1 and he gets taken down, but he does over 1,000 damage to both champions. Still going in on the fight. Zuna connects with the Q, but Snoopy is going to be able to get out with the ultimate here. Sadam is on, and they're safe.
Yeah, for now, let's see if Zuna can make something happen.
Yeah, he didn't want to go that far.
He went a little far, I'd have to say. But as did Pobelter. We have a couple of cowboys in this game just trying to do everything by themselves. Not a good idea. Pobelter, him being dead could be very dangerous. XTG's going to use that window to try and take down some turrets. I thought maybe they were going to try and rush Baron once again, knowing that the Gragas stealing Baron over the wall was not a possibility. But they were rather low from that as well. Xsmithy did nearly get picked off, and it ends up just being Dragon for a kill, which this late in the game is a gold advantage for EG.
What a weird fight. Everybody just started seeping out of the dragon pit into the jungle until somebody figured out what to do.
I think fights like that are going to be more prevalent in this game because EG is literally just waiting for opportunities.
Yeah.
They cannot play a brute force style of game, which is kind of what they want to do. It's this weird thing how Krepo used to be a big poke support with Soraka. Just heal up, wait forever for initiations, very old EG style. And then he found that Leona for himself and just wanted to be all in all the time. Now he's back to the passiveness. So everyone here in this game for EG has a little bit of poke support, and that's exactly what they're going to be trying to do in team fights.
4-0-3 on Xsmithy to the 1-2-0 of Yellow P. But last time we saw them fight, that 4-0-3 got pushed out of the 1v1.
He got pushed out pretty darn quick, and that's because Yellow P, you do not fight Urgot 1v1. A lot of that 15% damage reduction from his incredibly hard-to-name passive.
That one.
Just hugely impactful. It's like the Zahn Touch Bolt Augmenter or something.
You got it.
Wow, that's it.
Bam. Yeah. There you go. So we'll see where they decide to go with that. Looking at Xsmithy's inventory once more. We do see that Quicksilver Sash picked up for himself so he can get out of that hyperkinetic position.
This is really smart by XTG. If they could force it down and then initiate really quickly off of it. But if they start doing the poke battle, it's not as smart.
Not like that?
Yeah, that hurts right now. Luckily, it was just on Bloodwater. He can keep his distance in this fight. EG now seeking down the mid lane, and XTG is trying to fall back for it. I think they should have stayed on the Baron, personally, but that's an incredibly risky call against Gragas. XTG doesn't have too many high percentage plays here.
Let's see if they can get... Oh. All right. I thought Benny was going to try to walk past that one since Krepo is quite far from the fight, but XDG does not choose to move on this. They stay it safe. And these teams are definitely giving each other a lot of respect, which also leads into why they look at each other for 30 seconds at the Dragon Pit.
Well, they are playing for the second time this season.
Yep.
XDG took the first one in resounding fashion, so EG definitely trying to get some revenge. EG looked very defeated yesterday after their loss to Dignitas. Mm-hmm. And they definitely want to bounce back. And this is a big moment for them, if you think about it, because they went with the outside-the-box competition. Urgot and Soraka, two first-time picks in the North American LCS. And now they're the ones trying to two-man. This is quite good if they can zone out XTG, but it's very difficult for them to zone out with just poke right now. Siobhan is going to make it all the way through and stop this from happening.
This is crazy. Benny gets up there, but is it
good
too
silence.
Much damage? Yellow P is just chewing through that. Benny has to use Dragon's Descent to get out.
Oh!
One more hit. It comes across, but he keeps himself alive. The Baron has even more potential now. The cask taking down Bloodwater may have not been able to go back and fully heal.
They should go right back to the Baron right now because Benny will take so long to get back to this spot, and now it is just Zuna they have to zone out. But they used a lot of their ultimates in that last fight. They just have Cougar form up if you count that as an ultimate. Everything is down for EG. They're sieging the Baron right now.
Zuna, Lee Sin, that one that will be able to get in and out. Oh my gosh, Pobelter taking down Mancloud in the blink of an eye. And
that is Pobelter right there.
Really, really want to go for this.
I think it's all about the steal right now. Zuna can go in and make something happen. He's extremely low, though. EG isn't even trying to deal with the steal. They're trying to peel off. They got to finish that Baron.
Whoa. He even put the shield on. He thought he was getting it in the end. They are just trying to stall this, which they did a good job of, but now they're going to be faced with a train coming down mid lane.
Yeah, Baron buff, adding all the regen to all the healing that EG has right now. If they could actually go and secure a blue buff, they're not going to care about it because they think Soraka is enough right now. They do have a man advantage. This is the right time to push. Let's see if they can get this inhibitor clean off the back of the Baron.
Snoopy in the front. So is Pobelter here, trying to be that big front line that they need in these fights. They do a very nice job of quickly taking down the first inhibitor turret, now the inhibitor. Easy going through with the Baron on. XTG's forced to watch it.
You don't want that guy.
Nope.
You do not want to go into Snoopy.
He's hit a lot of hooks today, but they're all Snoopy on the other end, unfortunately.
and this is the late game that EG is generally comfortable in. XDG, when they were Vulcan in the last split, won most of their games by pulling out to resounding leads early and then letting ManCloud just kind of destroy the game and carry from there. That's not been the story so far this season, and definitely not this game. Despite there being a very weak early laning phase from EG, XGG was not able to pull ahead. There was that one misstep. I think without the 4 kills that XGG picked up at Dragonfight,
right,
EG would be in absolute control this game. You know, this is a much stronger EG team. And it's not that Vulcan or XGG has made too many mistakes. It's just I don't think they were ready for this strange of a team composition from Evil Geniuses. And they haven't really played it, or they just haven't known what to do, if that makes sense.
Well, strange on your own terms has kind of been victories here in the NALCS.
I think so too,
people forced onto the weird compositions, yeah, they falter, but it's worked really well.
Yeah, we've seen Jungle Pantheon and mid lane Akali work fantastically for Curse. We look at the European LCS, Team Rocket, Mordekaiser
mid,
Heyz mid lane Teemo. A lot of these weird things, like the ones that get the crowd excited, haven't worked in previous seasons, but so far in 2014, seem to be working really damn well.
We got a Soraka Urgot in this one. We'll see if EG can make it work for themselves as we come into this game. It was quite an interesting pickup by them, but we've seen them, as you said, get out of the laning phase safe.
Yeah.
XDG definitely made it hard for them, but they did good.
Playing against this now is just pure pain for XDG. There's so much poke they have to consider dealing with. If a Cleaver lands, it means the spears and the barrels are almost guaranteed. If Yellow Pete lands 1E, he can take someone down to half health. There's so many things that can potentially one-shot someone. XGG is just... there's no reward for dodging him either, because EG's just going to come back in the next wave and do more.
Yep, and they're going to get damage on the turret now. They don't have too much of that. As you can see, it's a little bit hard once they get in close. They're figuring out whether they need to cast on the champions or the structure.
Well, Urgot's not exactly a marksman as far as killing turrets goes, so that part of it's slow. EG literally just has to poke XGG off enough that they can melee the turret down. Snoopy is taking multiple turret hits, and that's their only way of getting a few autos in.
Ever so slowly. Ultimate's now being used. XDG has had enough of EG on the front step right now, and they're doing everything they can to push them away. This has to be stressing you out.
It's a pretty good siege defense.
It is.
So far by XDG. They're doing a great job keeping them off. EG's not fully committing, and XDG is making sure that EG has to fully commit in order to get this down. That's all they need.
Got him. Goes down. ManCloud cannot help the team this fight. The inhibitor turret is going to be there for the entire time as they try to fight around it. They look at it now. Refocus. Take it down. Baron's doing a lot for them this fight.
Yeah, 2 kills down right now. They're making sure to get that second inhibitor. They are just in complete control of this, and it was all about just waiting, finally hitting the dart. Now they're going in for more.
They have all the mana they need, that Jat. We said it before. They go for the Hypernetic Position Reverser onto Zuna. He may be able to make it out of the fight. The Acid Hunter on Safeguard. Oh, he flashed. He tried to flash on it. He still went down. Oh, unfortunate. The Nexus turrets are going to follow. And it looks like EG is going to be able to thwart out XDG.
What a team composition and strategy from EG in this one. They end 14,000 gold in ahead. 40-minute game. What else can you say?
New champions win it again. Urgot and Soraka in the bottom lane. Well played game by Evil Geniuses.
Yeah, EG need to find their style so far in the 2014 season. And they may have found something. Obviously, Urgot, Soraka can't work every game. It's very champion reliant for being banned. But if they can win with their own style, that's what's going to work for them. They haven't been able to win with everyone else's style. Let's see if this goes for them.
Those are the faces of a team that completed a strat that they practiced. That's something they worked on very hard. You can see them saying, did you see that work? Did you see this work? A lot of these games this week have been stressful wins. You don't even see smiles on some of the faces. But these guys, we might see something now from them.
Very promising win to close out a week. So that actually only moves them to 2-4 on the season, but there's plenty of games left. We got 28 games in an LCS split. Pretty good start. Trying to get that out.
I'm quite impressed.
Soraka Urgot. I spent the whole game talking about it, so it's like, it was nice the way it finally closed out, though. Just having close to max items on both of their poke bots.
Yeah.
One spear at the end. ManCloud zero kills once again, so that actually moves him to 11 kills in six games. He's actually under 2 kills a game now. He averaged 6 kills a game in the summer split of 2013.
That's kind of a few.
Huge slump right now for ManCloud.
And we talked about it. The top lane was having trouble. Benny was taking damage from Inox, right? And then Zuna came up top. The synergy was melding there.
Benny was doing quite well.
And then
well
Benny
for a lot
did quite
game.
Well, yeah.
The whole XGG strategy was to try and fast push. They had Shyvana, Ziggs, Sivir. Like, that is a pushing team, trying to get all the turrets down. They couldn't push far enough. It pushed back at them.
Yeah, we really got to ask when Zuna's going to actually try to synergize with ManCloud.
I wonder. I wonder what kind of team discussions they're having, because it seems like a great idea. They think, okay, we got the best mid laner in NA, which ManCloud was considered last split, and now we can make Benny the best top laner too. Let's do it.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of hopes there, and it helps as well for the motivation. Somebody else to point out in this match, who I think has not been underviewed but hasn't really been performing, was Snoopy, and then he took Mundo into the jungle, and he really made it work this game. He's kind of been falling behind in his position.
Yeah, he has not been having a good split so far, but he got into a lot of ganks at the right time. I think his mid lane support of Pobelter, he was kind of jumped on his back, got a bunch of assists in the mid lane, and then became tanky enough. Mundo with Soraka and Nidalee heals is just silly.
Looks like everybody just took a little bit of time to shake out all those nerves and get the comfort back in. Well, right now we've got to go AFK, but when we come back, Snoopy will sit down with Freak and Kobe to discuss Evil